much, Harry, and thank you, Will, as well. That was a really amazing talk on Brazil. I'm afraid, everyone, my talk tonight is going to get a lot drier than Will's. And that's largely because my interest is in xeric environments. So what is a xeric environment? It's basically a habitat which is defined by its aridity, and that's basically, in simple terms, how dry it is. And the reason I wanted to go on this trip to South Africa was that I wanted to explore the range of different xeric environments you get across South Africa and also see some of the amazing diversity of plants which grow there. So I'll start by talking through my route, which started in Cape Town down at the bottom here, and I travelled by biltong powered Land Cruiser up north, and I then stopped in Namaqualand before travelling on further north to the Richtersveld National Park, which borders Namibia. I spent about five days in the Richtersveld National Park before heading back down the west coast and exploring lots of the wildflower and the flowering meadows that happened down there. So on the right-hand side of this image here, you can see a very simplified map of the different biomes that you get in South Africa. So you have the Fynbos regions down here, marked in purple. You then enter into the succulent Karoo. And then up on the Namibian border, you have some of the only genuine desert found in South Africa there. So that's basically that. So I'll start by talking about Namaqualand. And I visited South Africa in their springtime. And this particular region of South Africa gets a lot of winter rains. And as a result of that, you get a really huge display of spring flowering plants in that particular habitat. So you get a wide range of annuals, ephemerals, geophytes, and things like that. And it really is a spectacular sight when you get up there. So here we have an example of some of the annual daisies you get here, like Gazania leopoda and Ixia ramulosa. But I specifically want to talk about this little plant down here, Gaultheria diffusa. And this is a really interesting plant to me because it's thought by many to be one of the most diverse kind of species, which has the most different floral morphology, basically. It has about 14 different flower types within its species. And everyone, kind of, it's quite well understood that when a new pollinator goes into a species, it can drive floral morphology and change, colours can change, and patterning can change, and also shapes. But interestingly, within this one species, where there are 14 different forms, they all share the same pollinator, which is this little bee fly down the bottom here. Now, why has there been so much kind of floral change in something which shares the same pollinator? And it turns out that actually this species here has three different approaches to attracting its pollinators. It has a feeding form, and these tend to have very simple flowers with very simple petals with very few markings. But they have pollen and they have nectar which can feed the visiting pollinator. The next form is the deceptive form. And the deceptive form is this one here. And they have markings on some of their petals. And these markings are thought to replicate and intrigue the male bee flies who visit these flowers, and they get deceived and they attempt to mate with these markings. And in doing so, they increase the chances of pollination. The final form here is the inspection form. And these are much less realistic, these markings. They don't actually deceive the bee fly, they just land on the petal, they inspect it, they go, oh, this isn't this, and they fly off. But I just think it's a really good example of actually how a species has been driven, divergence within a species has been caused basically by the male bee fly that you have here. Here's some other examples of geophytes I found in the Namaqualand. This is Pelargonium incrassatum. And Lacanalia anguinea, which has really attractive striped leaves. You see there. This is a Caritum raukii, and this is an annual plant, an annual succulent in the Asiaceae family. You actually get a really high percentage of annuals and ephemeral plants in xeric environments. And this is basically a form of an adaptation to survival. So they, when conditions are favourable and you have winter rains, they cram in their life cycle into a really short period of time, produce lots of seeds, and disperse them. And then in the period of when the weather is really inhospitable, they die back. So plants in xeric environments, annuals and that, really rely upon their seed banks. And they can be absolutely huge. A lot of annual and ephemeral plants actually also have seed dormancy. So when you have light and insignificant rain, the seeds don't suddenly germinate and burn off before they can reproduce. But this is a particularly striking Caritum, I thought. So here's some more annual flowering daisies, like this Gazania, these Dimorphophica. And actually the best places really to see a lot of these flowering meadows are along the roadsides. And I don't know if that's because the land gets disturbed less or more, but you do. And this is a particularly amazing bulb called Buffone Hymenopteris, and I saw a lot of those in the flowering meadows out there, and we have them in the tropical nursery at Kew as well. But they have an amazing band-shaped pattern to their foliage. So on to my first tree aloe. This is Aloea dichotoma, and it's known as the quiver tree, and it's called the quiver tree because the native people that live there in the past would use the hollowed out stems of these to store their arrows. The epithet name, dichotoma, is a reference to the branching pattern of these aloes, which they always branch into two. What's quite interesting about this aloe species is you quite often find it growing in populations of 20 or 30 plants, and then you don't tend to see many more. They kind of stick to these particular groups. And within these groups, you get kind of mature grandparent-type plants, maybe two or three of a very similar age. And then you tend to get adult plants. Again, you can also date them to around the same age, and maybe you get some juveniles, which is quite unusual. But I think it's really interesting because it shows that establishment within these plants is really sporadic. They depend on a series of years where the weather conditions are favourable in order to get established. And if they don't get those favourable years, they tend to fail. And it shows that they can be quite fragile, and climate change, which is happening quite staggeringly in these particular regions, may have a massive impact upon the establishment of new generations. So these plants really need to be monitored quite carefully, I think. Another thing that's quite interesting is that if you see this plant here, which is branching very low down to the ground, and you think that's quite unusual, it's actually an entire collection of different plants. In xeric environments, you quite often get seedlings germinating in clusters and groups together. And that's because there's a huge benefit, actually, in being in a group. You get a bit more shelter from the sun, and maybe you get a little less battering from the wind. And I like that. I think xeric environments, you see maybe a little bit less competition between plants. And that's a pretty good example of it. Actually, these plants here, quite often you'll see huge old mature specimens. And I think that they're actually probably quite a lot of plants that have grafted themselves together over time. I included this Sutherlandia frutescens because I think it's a really pretty plant for one, but it's also got a lot of medicinal importance in South Africa. It's used as to relieve fever and also digestive problems, and is kind of an all-time, all-round kind of medicinal plant used for the immune system. So the next part of my trip I'll show you is up here by Alexander Bay, and that is right on the border with Namibia. And there's some inconspicuous orange hills as you enter the town. And I was kind of driving along and I saw these orange hills and I thought, what on earth is covering these hills? And it is actually lichen. And I think I personally, before I travelled to xeric environments, associated lichens more with kind of moist and damp conditions in Scotland and Wales and hanging off branches. But actually, lichens are one of the most enduring things you can find. They can tolerate desiccation that flowering plants can't even imagine to do. And this here is a pretty amazing sight. So this is Telochistes capensis, which is probably the most common lichen you find out there. But there's also a wide range of other lichens that grow there. And they're not fussy, they'll grow on pretty much anything. This is a tyre of an old car which had broken down. So these lichen fields actually also host a huge range of succulent plant species. I'm sure a lot of you know about lithops, living stones. This was one that I found under a clump of lichen there. But also the lichen grows on the plants quite freely and actually probably plays quite an important role in gathering moisture. So a lot of these lichens can only exist because of sea mists, which bring in small quantities of moisture from the sea. And lichens can absorb moisture incredibly quickly. It's one of the things that means that they can survive in these conditions. And I'm sure that they play a major role in actually providing enough moisture for the other plants which grow there. So here's a few more plants which I found growing there, like Masonia papsonii, that's in the Geraniaceae family. This is a Medusoid euphorbia ramaglans, and also some other Crassula species at the bottom here. So the lichen fields by Alexandra Bay are actually positioned right next to one of South Africa's largest diamond mines. And diamond mining is kind of, I don't really know what to think about it in South Africa, because they own a huge amount of land which is protected. And that protected land actually often doesn't get used for mining, and actually in many respects protects the land there. But also, diamond mining produces a huge amount of spoil. They extract tons and tons of gravel which bears these diamonds. And these spoil heaps can cover absolutely monstrous ranges of land and quite mountainous. And the problem is these spoil heaps can never really be restored back to what they were. I think that all the topsoil is gone, but also they cover a lot of the other topsoil which holds the seed banks which are so vital to plants that grow in xeric environments. So onto my favourite location during the trip, which was the Richtersveld National Park. And the Richtersveld National Park is an amazingly lunar landscape-like place with huge amounts of different rock types. This is a picture here of one of the tree alley species that you find there. So what makes the Richtersveld so diverse? And that was kind of a question I wanted to ask, because a lot of these xeric environments I was visiting had a huge wealth of plants, and kind of the kind of thing you don't really imagine from a really dry habitat. And a lot of it, I think, comes down to the different rock types that you find. Can you see all these markings here that look a little bit like shadow and clouds that you find? And these are actually all different rock types. And you also get quartz drifts as well, which are also very important. But I think it's how, when water is available and how it interacts with these different rock types and the different soils that they produce, which creates the kind of different habitats and different niches into which this kind of wide variety of plants can grow. So where does the moisture in these xeric habitats actually come from? I was lucky enough while I was there to see a couple of sea mists roll in. And they're really amazing. They form on the top of the hills. And if you were to drive up and get out of your car and walk through them, you actually get completely soaked. And it's a really, these mists are vitally important for providing moisture for these plants. So this is the giant quiver tree, which is quite closely related to the tree aloe that I showed you earlier, Alopanthii. And it's a very, very rare plant. It's critically endangered, and there's only 200 or so of these plants left in the wild. And it's different from Aloe dichotome in that its inflorescence forms on the lower leaves of the rosette and droop downwards, whereas on dichotoma they point more upwards. But these are absolutely staggering plants. They're The trunks can form at about a meter girth, and they can grow to about 10 meters in height. So here's another really lovely aloe species, Aloe striata, subspecies Carisbergensis. And Aloe striata is quite easily identified by this kind of red margin that you get around the edge of the leaf here. It's very characteristic, so it was quite easy to identify that one. So here's another aloe species, which is endemic to the Richterswald. Aloe kersonsi only grows actually in two locations, but the populations of these plants are massive. They absolutely coat the landscape and the mountainsides and go on for miles, but it's a really very beautiful plant species. My course are probably completely sick of me talking about this plant. That's all I ever go on about. So I promise you this will be the last time I mention Macrophyllum damaquadum. It is probably the most iconic plant of the Richterswald, and it's known as the Halfmans. And it grows on southern slopes of the Richterswald, and it has this very characteristic lean. It leans to the north. And legend has it with local people that the Nama people that lived in the Mappeland were fleeing foreign invaders. And they ran into the Richterswald, and their god turned them into plants. They think that this characteristic lean to the north is them looking back to their ancestral homeland longingly, knowing that they'll never return. I think it's a very sad story, actually. But in fact, the lean north is more to do with the fact that you get more winter sun if you head in that direction. It is quite spooky, actually. When you're walking through the Richterswald and you see these silhouettes on the side of the hills, and they really do look like people sometimes. So here's another picture of the bark of Pacopodium namaquana, and this is probably the specimen I saw with the most branches, which was pretty impressive. And here it's the flowers you get and the leaves, and I promise you that's the last you'll ever. Euphorbia verosa, this is another species endemic to the Richterswald, and this is an incredibly poisonous Euphorbia species, hence the verosa. And it's used by the native people to poison the tips of arrows. I have a particular interest in this group of plants, which is Stapeliads, and this is Varolichia cactiformis, which it may be quite hard to love because it's quite knobbly, but I think it's pretty fascinating. And it's pollinated by carrion flies. Here's another plant in the same family, Apocidaceae, Microloma calycinum. And this is a kind of quite inconspicuous plant when it's not flowering. It's a climber, and it scrambles through kind of the scrub there. But it has a very beautiful flower structure that looks a bit like an ice cream. So another Stapeliad, this is Stapelia hirsuta vulgaripensis. And Stapeliads have a very complicated pollination method. And a little bit like orchids, they have pollinia, which is rather than having individual pollen grains, they have a collection of pollen which is congested together. And it's pollinated by flies, which fly and they get these pollinia stuck to their legs. And then they transport it to another flower and deposit it into the stigmatic lock, which is also very specific, and then you get the formation of the fruit, and that's the fruiting structure there, which is very characteristic of the family of Opossumaceae. Here's another Stapeliad, or Via namaquensis, which again has these markings of yellow and red, which is supposed to kind of mimic rotting flesh, and it also smells a lot like rotting flesh as well. And here's also a final collection of some of the succulent Opossumaceae that I saw in the room as well. So, quartz drifts. These are found actually throughout the succulent Karoo, which I mentioned earlier in the Mappeland, but also in the Richterswald as well. And quartz drifts are really fascinating because they create a very unique environment for plants. Because they're white and they reflect sunlight and heat, they're actually a lot cooler than the general surrounding environment, and this means that a greater diversity of plants can actually grow in them. And you find a lot of succulent Azoaceae growing there, like this Agaroderma here, which is nicely camouflaged in the quartz field, and the Euophytum nanum with the purple flowers. So these are actually some of the quartz drifts that I saw in the Mapland, and you can see here a range of succulent species with the Conophytum in the top left-hand corner. And they're really fascinating. You walk through these quartz fields and you have to be incredibly very careful not to stand on any of the plants that grow there, because they're incredibly hard to see some. An example of one that is incredibly hard to see is this Avonia paparacea. Now this species, the white scales you can see there are actually stipules rather than leaves, and the leaves are nestled beneath these stipules. And it manages to keep the temperature of the plant down by these stipules, which reflect light, but it also acts as amazing camouflage against predation. And there are plenty of animals out there that are looking for moisture, and these plants are kind of perfect for it, so it's pretty well camouflaged. Rosbezeckii, which is incredibly difficult to find as well. We were very lucky. You could look for hours and hours and we didn't find this. So here's a pelargonium that I saw in the Richtersveld National Park, Echinatum. You can see this growing in the Princess of Wales Conservatory. It was a pink form rather than a white form. It's a particularly nice pelargonium. Now this plant, which looks a bit like the doorknob with leaves, is actually Gephnis namabensis. And initially I thought, are those the bulbs there exposed above the ground? But the bulb is actually well beneath there and actually very sizable. Quite often you find with bulbs from South Africa and the arid regions, you get this spiralling of the leaves here. And I think that's largely actually to do with not getting damaged by wind. A lot of these xeric environments, specifically the Richtersveld, are very windy, and this protects and stops the leaves from getting quite so badly damaged. This here is a plant in the Geraniaceae family, and it's called the Bushman's Candle. It is a really useful plant to know if you're in the desert, because these stems, when dead and dry, can be burnt like a candle. They're full of fatty oils, and by burning them it can last for a long time. You can use it to light your fire and have your braai in the middle of the desert, which is really nice. Probably the only scary moment we had while we were on the trip was in the Richtersveld, and it was in the day we first drove in and we got a puncture in the middle of nowhere, and we obviously had to change the tyre, and we took the tyre off the back and jacked up the car, but then realised that the bolts we had to fix the wheel to the tyre weren't the right ones. And at that point I thought, oh, we don't have any other spare tyres. But luckily there was one more and the bolts were right, but it was pretty sketchy for a particular moment. So here's another attractive plant from the Richtersveld, James Britannia ramosissima, commonly known as the wedding flower. The desert rose, Hermannia stricta. And Nymania capensis, which has these really quite striking fruit capsules. And also very beautiful flowers, I think, even though they're understated. So here are some more xerophytes from there. Crassula decepta, which is a cap chasmophyte. You find it growing in the cracks of rocks. And Crassula cerisea. And this species here, which is very alien looking, Hydnora africana, is actually a parasitic plant. It has no chlorophyll at all, and it lives off the roots of Euphorbiae, plants in the Euphorbiaceae family. And this is another plant which is pollinated by insects, it's pollinated by beetles, that are drawn into it and they get trapped in the plant and create pollination. But it's a pretty weird plant. When I saw it, I thought, what on earth is that? The final bit of my trip is the journey back down the west coast here. And I thought I'd just end by showing you some of the amazing spring flowering meadows that you get down this region of South Africa. And as you can see, it's pretty amazing. They are just completely colourful and completely, you know, as far as the eye can see daisies. There's a huge diversity in the daisies and the Asteraceae family, and you actually need to know quite a lot about the plant to be able to identify a lot of them. So I saw, did see some nice Aerophyte swallows there as well, a bit like this Euphorbia Schoenlandii. And another parasitic plant, Hierobatrachis sanguinea, and that grows on the roots of Proteaceae, to name one of its things. And I'll end on a nice little geophyte, this Ferraria crispa, which is also pollinated by flies and smells pretty awful. That is very beautiful. So thank you to the Kew Guild for helping fund this trip, the Royal Horticultural Society, Bentham and Moxon Trust, my guide, Pete, who is invaluable, Kirsten Bosch, Botanic Garden, Brixfield Natural Park Ranges.